This week on Moms Like Us, first up, Tia Mowry chats about why she and her husband schedule sex.
What's also important to us is our marriage. And, you know, marriage, it takes work.
Then Nicole Polizzi reveals how she and husband Gianni get time away from their kids.
Literally, when I know we're going to do like our wine movie night, we know it's going down. So it's like, all right, tonight's the night.
Plus, Tan Fran says this is the biggest mistake people make when picking a donor.
Just because you have two people who are attractive does not mean that your child is going to be gorgeous.
We've got all that plus so much more on today's Moms Like Us. Hi guys, Mandy DeCamp. Welcome to Moms Like Us. I'm here with Brianne Manns from Stroller in the City. Hi, Brianne.
Hey, Mandy. How's it going?
I'm doing well, doing well. I want to get right into the news this week. We have a lot to get to.
Yeah.
We sat down with Tia Mowry and she explained why her and her husband schedule sex. So let's see what she has to say. Do you and your husband still schedule that intimate time? I know you said that in the past.
Of course we do. Of course it's important. I really, really think it's important. And I think it's a sign that indicates how essential, you know, your marriage is. You know, it's important to make sure that you are realistic when it comes to having a busy life, when it comes to being pulled in so many different directions, when you are working parents. So what's also important to us is our marriage. And, you know, marriage, it takes work. I think for someone who says that it doesn't take work, I'm like, I don't know. I don't know if that's true.
Yeah.
And so I think that's with everything, you know what I mean? And communication is the most important thing. One of the most important things, I think, in a union. And that's what it is. It's about communication.
I know that you and your husband had said no more kids, or you haven't said
no more kids. No more kids. I love what I do. And I love the balance that we have right now in the house. You know what I mean? With just two kids, I can take on one. My husband can take on one. Yeah. And right now it's amazing. But I will say this, never say never. You never know what God has in store. But right now, no.
So I don't know. What do you think about this? Would you do this? Do you do this?
I mean, I feel like I do know a couple of couples that do this. Yeah. Me personally, I'm not on a schedule. I work better when I'm like off schedule kind of thing, whether it's work or home life, you know?
Yeah.
I'm not a scheduler. How about you?
No, not at all. I mean, I don't have time to schedule. What do you mean? Like, do you write it in your phone? Like, I don't know. I especially since we've been working from home, I used to be so like a person who had a planner that wrote stuff down. I don't do that at all anymore. Everything's in my head and hopefully I show up, but yeah, no, this is not something I do and not something I think I would do. However, I do think it's important to figure out Thursday, let's do date night, you know, and find a sitter.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Scheduling date night is definitely for sure. So that also leads me to, we talked to Nicole Snooki Polizzi this week about how her and her husband Gianni make time for each other, despite three kids running around. So take a listen to this.
How do you and Gianni make time for yourselves? Do you find yourself locking the door to keep the kids out these days?
Well, usually what we do to like have our own time, if like we're not going on a date or something, is the kids will go to sleep at like 8:39. So when everyone's knocked out, we'll go in our room and we'll have like a glass of wine and like cheese and crackers. And we'll watch movies until like 3 a.m. and just like hang out and just watch movies that curse and like murder movies and just like be ourselves for a couple hours.
That's awesome. How do you keep things sexy with each other? Do you surprise him with, you know, presents or anything like that?
No, I don't have time for that. Literally, when I know we're going to do like our wine movie night, we know it's going down. So it's like, all right, tonight's the night. But yeah, we're not. Yeah, I'm tired. I feel like I'm like 60 years old. So we try and do it as much as possible. But I mean,
yeah,
it's fine.
Yeah. So same thing with them. What I loved about her is that she and her husband actually lock themselves in the bedroom and put on, she said, murder movies or anything they can't watch around the kids, basically, which is, you know, I love that. and they take the wine, they bring cheese into the bedroom, which is funny. So it's like a little date night in their bedroom, which is cute.
Absolutely. And I definitely think scheduling something like that with your husband mm-hmm. is like definitely a must. Like yesterday, my husband and I went for like a lunch. We left the kids, you know, they were on their school Zooms, and like, we just like went out for lunch for an hour, you know, it's like just little things like that, like just to try to make like together time to, you know, with one another.
That's awesome. Yeah. What we do a lot, we used to do it more when we were living in Brooklyn, but now that we're sort of in Long Island now, we used to get takeout on Thursdays. So it'd be like, what I actually love since quarantine is you can get a lot of the drinks to go, except I think they're stopping that this week.
I think they are.
Yeah, I think today. So we used to like go pick up takeout and then have like a to-go drink on the way home. And that was kind of like, you know, without sitting down at a restaurant, you can still be with the baby. Mm-hmm. You can still have your fancy cocktails that you didn't have to make, but kind of enjoy it in the comfort of your home. And that's kind of what she does, is like bring the wine and cheese to the bed. Why not?
Right. I
love that.
Especially if you get a sitter.
Yeah, exactly. Do you have to get a sitter for your kids, or does the oldest watch?
No, we kind of do. We kind of do. If it's like an afternoon thing, it's okay if like, you know, we leave them for an hour or so. Mm-hmm. But if it's like a nighttime thing, especially like being in the house, mm-hmm. we definitely need a sitter, which I have yet to find. So if anyone has anyone out in Long Island, let me know.
Yeah. If I was closer, I'd come over. All right. So we also sat down with Tan France from Queer Eye. He's one of my favorites. He and his husband are expecting a baby this summer, a baby boy. And he talked to us about the surrogate and donor journey that they've gone through, and it's been a long, long process. So let's listen to this. What advice would you share with someone who is struggling with either the donor or the surrogacy process right now?
First off, it is an incredibly expensive process. I understand that we are in a very, very privileged position. But I would say for this donor process, go for somebody for the right reasons, not because they're hot. The amount of people who have asked, oh, how attractive is she? I couldn't care less. Yeah. Like, did you go for somebody that looks like a supermodel? Couldn't care less. That is not important. Those things. I know many people in my own family, their parents, bless them, are not very attractive. My aunt and uncle, I won't name which ones, but they're not very attractive people. They have the most beautiful, my cousins are the most beautiful people I've ever seen in my life, and their parents were not attractive. So really, do not base it on looks. You never know what you're going to get. Just because you have two people who are attractive does not mean that your child is going to be gorgeous. So don't be so superficial.
Do you know if you want them to be a part yet?
I do.
You do? Okay.
Absolutely. Good. There are. I did a post about it when I posted the announcement.
Mm-hmm.
We were inundated with beautiful, beautiful messages, but like 5%, maybe 3% were really horrible. And it was basically, this is terrible that you're doing this. Babies should only be conceived naturally, like that kind of thing. And the people seemed to think that I was kidnapping a lady, raping her, and trapping her in my basement, tying her to a radiator until she had my baby. That couldn't be further from the truth.
Oh my God.
This woman really wanted to be my surrogate. We have a wonderful relationship. Yeah. I think that there's a really archaic idea of what surrogacy and IVF is.
Yeah.
And these babies aren't real babies. They're, the amount of times I hear that they're artificial babies, they're not artificial babies. Like, get out of it. Blew my mind. We were so shocked by many of these comments. I just think, gosh, I wish people understood this process better, which is why I like talking about it.
I think he said he wants their donor and surrogate to be a part of the kid's life after. What do you think about that? Is that something that you would want?
That's not something that I've heard of. Mm-hmm. But I think that is nice, since they are part of the process to get there. I mean, I think that's great if that's what he wants. You know, I haven't heard that being like the norm, but I think that's like awesome that he wants to do that.
Yeah. I don't know what I would do in that situation. I don't know if I would want them to be a part of it. I feel like I'd want the option to choose later down the road, you know, which I think a lot of people do with adoption, is maybe they like keep an open communication. So I don't know. It would scare me, but I like that he's doing it, because I think it will be nice for their child to have that.
Oh, without a doubt, without a doubt. And also for the child to know, 100%. So I think that's awesome.
Yeah. What he also said is the biggest mistake people make when choosing a donor is they're superficial and they look at people if they're good looking or not, which I totally would probably do if I was looking for a donor, if I'm being honest. Right. But I mean, have you ever thought about that? Like,
no, I've had someone do that. And yeah, they were saying that they wanted someone with like, you know, that was tall and had like light eyes. So I think that is someone's first choice when they are looking for a donor. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy. I mean, it would be so hard to pick. I don't know.
I think I would go nuts, you know, trying to figure that out. You know, I think it would take me like months to decide, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. He said that part was harder than finding a surrogate, because a surrogate, I mean, is also important, but the donor is like in your child. So right.
Genes and everything and family history and all of that stuff that you have to like, you know, think about for sure.
Yeah. I think I would, I mean, you're not going to not look at what they look like, but I think I would look at how smart they are. Like their IQ.
Yeah, you have to, for sure. Yeah. I think that's like that plays like a major role and any kind of like gene or something, because, you know, in my family, and I'm totally getting real now, like not on my side, on my husband's side, it's like the ADD factor is like rampant.
Yeah.
And, you know, it passes down and, you know, you know, my son has that as well. Mm-hmm. And, you know, my husband's always like, I always thought I was, you know, growing up, but like never treated it because that's what happened back then.
Yeah.
So now I have, you know, a son that has it and I'm like, oh my God, it's like a real thing that it just like passes down in the genes. So I definitely think now that I'm aware of that, I would definitely look into something like that.
Totally. Yeah. Medical history, what their IQ is or education or whatever, whatever they give you. I don't really know what they give you, but, and then maybe if there's any like crime or history of arrests.
I wouldn't even think that, but that's,
I don't know. It just came to me. But yeah, I don't know. Maybe looks would go further down on that list as you think of the things that are more important to you.
Totally. I wonder how they break it down. I'm going to look that up.
Yeah, please do.
I'll report back next week.
Okay. All right. So our mom's getting real moment this week goes to Lauren Burnham Lyandake. She shared a photo just 11 days after giving birth to their twins. This photo is insane. I mean, she does still have a little bit of a bump. She captioned this: 11 days postpartum, just a reminder that not everyone gets a flat tummy back after popping babies out, and it's all good. Proud of the squishy belly, even if I have to ask what could possibly be in there, LOL. So we know she and Ari revealed their twin names. They're Senna and Lux, very cute. And the girl who was in the hospital, they're both now home with them. So that's great. So happy for them. But let's talk about this photo. What do you think about this? She looks great.
I think she looks great, but I also love the fact that a lot more women are doing this postpartum, because I think that we always had this thing in our heads that, oh my God, you're going to get back to normal right after you have a baby, and you're not. And it took me well over a year with my first, like to finally feel normal, and that's okay. And I think every woman's different. And I think it just takes time, you know, and I like that she's being real and candid. I'm happy that a lot more celebrities are coming out and doing this.
I agree. So another person posted this week, Sierra Dawn, she was a Survivor alum. She had a baby 3 weeks ago, a baby daughter named Della. And she posted this photo on a walk. She doesn't have any belly, like none. So I'm just like, does this give women unrealistic expectations of what's going to happen 3 weeks after giving birth? Because clearly, I mean, this is crazy. She looks like she never had a baby.
She looks stunning, and kudos to her.
Yeah.
And I don't, you know, obviously it wasn't photoshopped or anything like that. I just think that we have to remind ourselves that we're all different. We're all different. And even like the three different pregnancies for me, my afterbirths all looked so different. Like I did crazy. I did nothing with my first, 'cause I was like nervous about doing everything. You know, I did like light exercises. I was crazy yoga with my second, and I looked probably the best after that, but I also did yoga, you know?
Yeah.
I don't think she was giving anybody a realistic, like, oh, this is what you're going to look like after. Yeah. She probably didn't mean to do that, but I think we all have to remind ourselves we're all different, and we all bounce back differently.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. With my first, I walked like crazy. Once I was starting to feel better, the first 17 weeks I laid in bed pretty much, but once I was starting to feel better, I walked a lot. And actually, like right after, I felt good. I was like, I look good, I think. But then because I was so nauseous during my pregnancy, I wasn't eating. And obviously I wasn't drinking wine. So I think once I started like eating normally, when I was like, the second she came out, it was like, I feel great. I want to eat a hamburger and have a glass of wine. So when I started doing that again, it's like now the 6 month mark where I'm like, oh my God, I need to start doing stuff again and start eating healthier because it's weird. Like initially I was like, oh, I look great. I don't have to lose that much because I didn't gain that much because I was so nauseous.
Yes. But you know what happened for me too? It was after I finished nursing with my children that I felt me packing on the pounds, because when you're nursing, you're burning so many calories and it's like, you're doing a workout every day without doing it. And that's when I was like, oh, I'm not nursing anymore. I'm gaining back the weight. You know, it's
I agree.
Just different for our bodies.
It is. It just depends on who you are.
Exactly. So our clapback of the week goes to Aubrey Rainey. She shares a baby with Mark Cuevas from Love is Blind. An Instagram user asked how she and Mark could leave their baby to go on vacation. She replied, for anyone else who's wondering why we're on a trip, this isn't a vacation for us. We will be back home with Ace Sunday, less than 48 hours. But in the meantime, he's with my loving parents, spending quality time and being taken care of. I mean, we're baffled every week with our clapbacks, but I mean, she's gone for less than 48 hours. I mean, when do you think it's like, did you leave? When was the earliest?
I went to a wedding probably 2 months ago and it was 3 hours away. So we stayed in a hotel and we left the baby with my mom overnight and I was fine. I thought I was going to have like all this anxiety and I truly didn't, which I feel bad saying, but like, I mean, it was also my mom. So it's not like I'm leaving her with a stranger, but they're leaving their kid with parents too. So
yeah,
I think as long as you trust who's watching them, I think it's fine. And
absolutely. Especially when it's the grandparents, you know, I definitely feel like, oh my God, get away and do it. You know what I mean? It's not like she was going on a 2 week vacation without the baby. Like I remember, I can't remember how old my son was, but we had a wedding, same thing, right after he was born. And I remember going and spending the night. I was a little nervous to leave. The biggest problem during that time away was like the pumping, just like remembering like, oh my God, it's, I have to keep pumping. Like that was like the biggest thing for me.
Right.
But good for her, you know?
Yeah. I have to say, like, I don't know if I do more than like 2 or 3 nights right now. My husband is like fine with that. Like, he's like, oh, we should do like a 3-night trip to New Orleans or do this or that. And I'm like, pump the brakes. Like, I don't know if I'm ready until she's like over 1. But I think 1 or 2 nights is fine.
For sure. And everyone needs a break from, and to sleep. Everyone needs to be able to sleep once in a while.
Exactly. Okay. So we're adding a new segment, our celeb mom and dad poll of the week. So our poll this week is, what do you think about over the top kid parties, kid or baby parties? Are they a do or are they a don't? This came up because Joanna Gaines posted a photo, a very simple photo of her son's third birthday. And it looked like a normal person's party. It was a little dinosaur, a little, strand of decorations. And I was like, what, can't we go back to that? It's insane these days. There's these over the top lawn signs. There's the balloon arches. I mean, we've seen all the Kardashian baby parties, which they won't remember. So I don't know. Where do you stand on this poll?
I stand with you. I'm not into the over the top party at all. Like, I mean, yes, go all out, first birthday, whatever, but like the whole, the balloon arch situation that are in the backyard. And then like the tables that are all set up that are like perfectly done. I'm not that person. I'm never that person. Like I'm more like low key. And my kids are kind of like that too, which is kind of nice.
That is nice. I love I'm crafty. So I thought I could do this a few weeks ago. We were having my daughter's baptism party and I bought this rainbow balloon thing from Amazon. And we have a picture of what it's supposed to look like and what it actually looked like. So, I mean, take a look. So yeah, it's so bad. I mean, and I'm crafty and I'm like, these people must hire people, right? Like
yes, they do. And then they tag like the event planners. I mean, the event planners are like raking it in this year. Event planners, they come and they set up the whole thing. It's crazy.
Especially like I used to do this stuff more also before I had Amelia when I had more time. But now when you have a little baby, like if you can't do it in 5 minutes, it's not getting done.
No, I think like the main focus is the company, right? To have mm-hmm. like amazing family and friends around you. Yeah. And I also think like food is also like the important thing. Food so like focus on that.
People care about that.
I don't think that you really need to go crazy with the decor. I'm like more of a simple person too. And I rather just like something simple and call it a day.
Absolutely. I agree. So you guys tell us in the comments, are you for the over the top parties or not?
Yes. We want to know. So in today's baby name diaries, Snooki is back and sharing the meanings behind her three kids' names. Take a look at this.
Yeah. So Lorenzo, I always pictured my first son to be Lorenzo. It was like written in my head. So Lorenzo Dominic, which is his middle name. So that's after my uncle. And then Giovanna, I always wanted a girl named Giovanna since I was like 4. So when I got my first dog, I named her Gia for Giovanna. So then I knew Giovanna. And then Angelo, me and Gianni just loved Angelo. And we kind of had to stick with like the Italian names. Like we couldn't do Lorenzo Giovanna, then like Ralph. Like we had to keep it going with the vowels. So we did Angelo. And then his middle name is James after his great grandfather and his uncle. So
That. So thoughts on all of her baby names. They're all Italian, which I love.
I love it too. Theme.
It. Yeah, they're both super Italian. So go for it.
Yeah, I love it. I mean, I live on Long Island, which is, I have a ton of Italian friends and I think they all have Lorenzo's, Giovanna's, Michelangelo's, you know, so I'm used to it. I love it. Embrace your culture. I'm all for it.
Yes, totally. I agree.
Okay, so today's Say All moment goes to Alec Baldwin and his adorable family on the red carpet for the premiere of Boss Baby Family Business. Alec and his wife, Hilaria, all matched their 6 kids in black suits and neckties at the premiere. Hilaria captioned it, "Some bossy Baldwinitos," while Alec said, "Will the real boss baby please stand up?" I don't know. This family's so cute. They annoy me because they're so cute.
There's just so many of them. I can't keep up, but they are so cute. Like Hilaria is pretty hilarious, you know?
Yes.
She keeps it real and I love them for it.
She actually ended up saying too, her pants on the red carpet were Express. She bought them when she was like 19 years old for $19.99 and she still had them, which I love because I'm like, I still have a pair of Express pants probably from when I was 19.
Yes. Oh my God. I remember I had to apply for a credit card because I had no money and I wanted to like shop there. So yeah, I like maxed out a credit card there.
I loved Express back in the day. So I could relate to her. And I mean, just getting that many kids to a red carpet, all matching, all still with their neckties on. Good for her. I don't know how she does it.
Kudos to her for sure.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Brianne. And thank you to our guests. Have a lovely weekend and we'll see you next week.
Yes. Thank you, Mandy. Enjoy the rest of the week and the sunshine.
Yes. Bye, guys.
Bye.